In the last subunit, I introduced the self-similarity dimension, and we calculated the self-similarity dimension for three different fractals, the fractal snowflake, the Sierpinski triangle, and the Koch curve. In this subunit, I'll make a number of other remarks about fractals, including thinking about what self-similarity means and what it means to say something is scale-free. And I'll also try to address a question that is quite likely on your mind, which is, what's up with non-integer dimensions? How can it make sense for an object to have a dimension that's not one or two, but is something in between? How can we even think about that? So to begin addressing that, to get some new ways to think about this, we're going to start by asking the question, how long is the Koch curve? So the question before us is, how long is the Koch curve? As a reminder, you calculated its dimension in the previous section. Here are the steps in its construction. So what I'm going to do is come up with an expression for the length at the zeroth step, the initial step, and then after one step, two steps, three steps, and so on, and we'll see what happens. So I'm going to say, let's call this initial length 1, just for convenience's sake. Let's say this is a meter or something. So I'm going to fill out this table here. So at step 0, initially, how long is each line segment? Well, there's only one line segment, and it has length 1. So the total length is 1. There's one line segment of length 1. Total length is 1. Okay. What about at the first step? Now there are 4 line segments, 1, 2, 3, 4. And each line segment is 1/3 the length of the original line segment. So step 1, length of each line segment is 1/3. The number of line segments is 4. And if we have 4 things, each of which have a length of 1/3, the total length is 4/3. All right. What about at step 2? Well, the process repeats. If I just look at this section here, I go from one line segment to 1, 2, 3, 4 line segments. But that same story happens here, here, and here. So there are now 16, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and so on, line segments. All right, so step 2, there are 16 line segments. By the way, 16 is 4 squared. I have 4 segments here, and then 1, 2, 3, 4 shaped like that. 4 times 4 is 16. Okay, so now this length is 1/3. This length and each of the other lengths is 1/3 of 1/3. So that's 1/9. So that's 1/9. Which is 1/3 of 1/3, which is also 1/3 squared. So if I have 16 things, each of which have a length of 1/9, and the total length is 16/9, which happens to be 4/3 squared. All right. You can probably see the pattern that's taking shape here. Let's do step 3 quickly. So if I just focus on this little piece here, I go from this length to this length, and I now have 4 times as many segments as I did before. At every step, the number of line segments goes up by a factor of 4, is multiplied by 4. So now I'm going to have, this is step 3, 4 times 4 times 4, which is 4 cubed. At each step, the length of the line segment goes down by 1/3. This was 1, this is 1/3, this is 1/3 of 1/3, this is 1/3 of 1/3 of 1/3. That's 1/3 cubed. So let's see, that's 1/3 cubed. So if I have 4 cubed things, each of which has a length of 1/3 cubed, then the total length is going to be 4/3 cubed. Notice, by the way, that the length is getting longer. And that's pretty easy to see. This is length 1. Now I've added a detour. So clearly, this path with the bend in it is longer than this. Every time I add a bend in the path, I'm adding length. So the length is getting larger and larger. We can generalize this. We see the pattern now. At the nth step, each line segment has been cut in thirds n times. At every step, the number of line segments is multiplied by 4, so that the total length is 4/3 to the n. So now the question is, what happens as n gets larger and larger and larger? And you can see what's happening here. This number is getting larger and larger and larger. 4/3 multiplied by itself again and again and again, it's always getting larger. You're adding 33% every time. So as n gets larger and larger, the total length also gets larger and larger. Let's say that it goes to infinity. So here is a picture. Let's see. Get some new background here. So here is a picture of the Koch curve. This I did on a computer out to, I think, 6 steps. It's the resolution wouldn't let me go any farther. You wouldn't be able to see it. And so as we continue the iteration process at every step, adding a bend in every line, then the length of this curve becomes infinite. So this curve here is going to have infinite length. So we have a curve that's infinitely long, but it's clearly contained in a finite area. I can draw a circle around it. The area in here is definitely finite. This is just some little oval. On my paper, it's about the size of my hand. Nevertheless, I can fit one of these wiggly Koch curves in here that actually has infinite length. So one of the things about fractals is that they combine qualities of finite and infinite in interesting ways. And in fact, that was some of the original motivation for these constructions in the early 1900s. Mathematicians were looking at set theory and trying to think about different properties of infinities. So in any event, the Koch curve has an infinite length, although clearly you can fit that infinite length in a finite area. So now let's think about the dimension of the Koch curve. Recall that we found previously that its dimension was log 4 over log 3, which is approximately 1.262. So it's in between 1 and 2 dimensions. So one way to think about this is that objects with these sorts of dimensions, between 1 and 2, have some features or qualities that are one-dimensional and some that are two-dimensional. So it's one-dimensional in that it's made up out of lines, right? Remember, in our construction, we started with a line and put a wiggle in it and or put a bump in it, put bumps in it, put bumps on the bumps, and so on and so on and so on, and we ended up with this shape. So it's one-dimensional, in a sense, or has one-dimensional qualities, because it started as a line, and in a sense, it still is a line. However, it has so many bumps in it, and the shape becomes so jagged, so many teeth, teeth on teeth on teeth, bumps on bumps on bumps, that it starts to bump up, sort of push up into the second dimension. It's not fully two-dimensional, like an area. It doesn't really take up space, but the line becomes so bumpy that it has some sort of two-dimensional features. That's not a precise argument by any means, but just qualitatively, it's a way to think about these non-integer dimensions. They combine, so something that's between dimensions 1 and 2 is sort of one-dimensional, sort of two-dimensional. So another thing to think about with a Koch curve is, as we've said, in a finite area, it has an infinite length. So that would be really beneficial if this was maybe part of a lung or some organ or structure that was trying to exchange, that wanted to have a large surface area. Maybe this is a shape that is trying to dissipate heat. So it could be something physical. It doesn't have to be biological. So this large surface area would be, i.e. this large long perimeter, this large length, would be really beneficial because it'll be a large length across which the heat could dissipate or oxygen could be exchanged or something. So that's another interesting feature of these sorts of fractals. So I said before, they combine finite and infinite, and that could have some real structural advantages depending on the particular application.